watching. The buck stops here, and I'm back. Khadat. The big political story this evening is, of course, the battlefield that Arunachal Pradesh has become between the Congress and the BJP. This after the recommendation for president's rule in Arunachal Pradesh, the Congress taking that battle to Rashtrapati Bhavan today. But the Rashtrapati, Pranab Mukherjee, has not revealed his mind. While it was initially reported that he had given his assent to the cabinet recommendation for president's rule, there are now reports that President Pranab Mukherjee met with Home Minister Rajnath Singh this afternoon and asked for clarifications as to why President's rule in the circumstances is an inevitability. On the program today, we look at whose argument is stronger on the Arunachal Pradesh Game of Thrones unfolding as the latest political drama. Who has the most convincing storyline? Who has the more convincing argument? The BJP says it's a constitutional breakdown. The Congress, led by Rahul Gandhi, is calling it a murder of democracy. Let's introduce our guests who are facing off on the buck stops here tonight. From the BJP, we're joined by GVL Narasimha Rao. From the Congress, we're joined by Mr. Narayan Swamy. Let me start by asking you, Mr. Narayan Swamy, you took your battle to the president today. The president has not revealed his mind, but the fact of the matter is the Congress no longer has the numbers. You no longer have the majority because a section of your party has joined hands with the BJP. So even if there were no president's rule, you do not have the numbers. On what grounds then do you want the government to continue?
No, it is not correct to say that we don't have the numbers. We have 47 MLAs were with the Congress. Some of them have been broken by the BJP. The BJP played its game for the last three, four months, and they tried to break the Congress. And they used the right from the top leadership of the BJP, and including the Minister of State for the Home, Mr. Kiran Rijiju, all of them were involved in the whole process of destabilizing the duly elected, constitutionally elected Congress government in Arunachal Pradesh. It is not the question of number. It is the question of actually, out of 47 MLAs, 14 have been disqualified by the speaker. Now the matter is before the court. Therefore, the total, we have got 31 members now who are the Congress members. Where is the question of Congress is not having the members?
So you are saying that the people who defected from your party have been disqualified by the speaker, Mr. Narayan Swamy. Your MLAs, you say, have been disqualified by the speaker, but that speaker has been impeached in an alternative, in a parallel proceeding. So whether the speaker's decision applies or not is also questionable.
No, but we are questioning questioning the authority of the governor, the powers. We are questioning the powers of the governor to call the session suo moto without the decision of the cabinet, without taking the state government into confidence, because you should know the background. Previously there was a governor in Arunachal Pradesh. He was changed. They brought Rajkova there, who is a gutter RSS man, and he was installed there for the purpose of destabilizing our government. And he started acting as a parallel government there. The Raj Bhavan has been used as the BJP headquarters in Arunachal Pradesh, Itanagar. From time to time, we brought it to the notice of the government of India. We brought it to the notice of the president of India. And the governor wanted to destabilize our government. Let me finish within 1 minute. And the governor has no powers to call the session without the cabinet decision. We challenged it before the court. The Guwahati High Court has held it in their favor. Now the constitutional bench of the Supreme Court is hearing the matter. There is a hurry for the government of India to go over a president rule?
Okay, Mr. Narayan Swamy, let GVL Narasimha Rao come in. Mr. Rao, the question is this. The fact is that it was in a makeshift venue that the speaker was impeached. There is a question mark over why that was necessary. That impeachment did not even take place inside the assembly. The political message that is going out is not just to the Congress, but even people like Arvind Kejriwal and Nitish Kumar today saying that this is the death of federalism. The Prime Minister talks about cooperative federalism, but you have imposed president's rule in extremely questionable circumstances when the matter was still in the court.
Barkha, Prime Minister genuinely believes in cooperative federalism, but that does not mean that we will allow illegitimate governments, illegitimate governments to function in the country. That does not mean that we will let governments continue which are in the breach of the Constitution. Congress party making these statements is like devil quoting the scriptures. And for the last 6 months, why was it unable to convene a state assembly? Why is there the gap of 6 months have lapsed? Clearly, Article 174 suggests that a government, a house should be convened at least once within 6 months. You have clearly a situation where the constitutional mechanism has broken down in the state, and they do not have numbers even today. They are making only a political drama in Delhi. If they have the numbers even today, why can't they show?
Mr. Rao, Jeevan Rao, they are making the argument. Yeah. Narayan Swamy, you heard, is making the argument that those members have been disqualified. So you cannot count them in your kitty as well. That's point one. Point two is the president has not, as far as we know, automatically signed this recommendation. He's actually asked the Home Minister for clarifications. Does it worry you that maybe the president could send this recommendation back to the cabinet?
No, I do not want to comment on any hypothetical situations, Barka. Clearly, there is a constitutional breakdown. I don't see any possibility of this recommendation not being accepted, because you cannot have a government in office which is in the breach of the constitution. No, I think constitutional functionary would really allow such a situation to prevail. And the disqualification of the MLAs that Congress is talking about is itself a very illegal, unethical act, which was actually taken at a time when the governor had convened the assembly on December 16 in Itanagar. I think Congress party tried every desperate measure and has broken every norm to somehow remain in power in Arunachal Pradesh through unethical, illegal, unconstitutional means. When all this has not helped, they are only creating a drama. They are only creating a situation in Delhi. If they have the numbers, I challenge him to prove these numbers tomorrow. Do they have the numbers today? If they do not have, what right do they have to remain in power?
Take that. Where are the numbers? Has your government reduced to a minority?
I would like to tell you, because as on date, there are 31 members for the Congress. And apart from that, whether BJP is claiming that our members have joined their party, none of them have joined their party. The BJP is engineered defection there. The governor acted in unconstitutional, illegal and unethical manner. And he was installed there by the BJP top brass here in Delhi to destabilize our duly elected Congress government. The governor created the crisis. Now the Narasimha Rao is telling that the crisis has been created. By who created the crisis? This government, the NDA government, appointing an RSS man.
What about your 21 rebel MLAs?
No, but let me tell you about the MLAs. Let me tell you about 21 rebel MLAs, because when 14 have been disqualified, it is being challenged before the court. No, let me tell you that 14 people have been disqualified. And apart from that, when the constitutional bench is hearing the whole case, what is the urgency for the government of India, the Narendra Modi government, to go for a president rule? Because they know pretty well the Supreme Court will hold it in our favor, fearing that for the purpose of upsetting that, they are now trying to bring a president rule so that they can save their face.
Okay, let GVL respond. Narayan Swamy saying 14 have been disqualified, so the mathematics is not as simple as you make it out to be.
No, I think this disqualification is patently unethical, illegal. The speaker did not have the confidence of the house when he took that decision. He took that abrupt decision when the governor had already convened the house. I think it was clearly a vengeful step, an act desperately in power. But as far as the Supreme Court is concerned, Mr. Swami, let me finish. Please let me finish. I'm not finished.
Narayan Swami, let GVL Narasimha Rao complete his point. GVL Rao, please complete your point.
Yeah. I think Supreme Court, when it examined this case on the 16th of January, the Supreme Court has asked the petitioners, has asked the lawyers representing the Chief Minister of Arunachal Pradesh, whether he was willing to convene the House, the Assembly, on January 20th and to prove his majority on the floor of the House with a pro tem speaker in the chair.
Yes.
This was an offer given by the Honorable Supreme Court. The Congress Party does not have the numbers. Therefore, they did not even take this appeal from this suggestion from the Supreme Court. They're simply crying and making a political drama outside in New Delhi, while they clearly know they don't have the numbers. They want to remain in power illegally without having the confidence of the House, without having a majority. So why was the House not convened for 6 months? That's a simple question.
Narayan Swami, please answer it.
Narasimha Rao ji is referring to Supreme Court proceedings. The Supreme Court very clearly, after hearing both the sides, yes, we filed a petition before the Supreme Court saying that we would like to convene the assembly session. We told the court you decide on those 14 MLAs. Before the Supreme Court, the counsel who is appearing for the governor made it very clear to the court that we will not take any precipitative action till the constitution bench decide the case. This is the undertaking given by the counsel who is appearing for the governor. Because since the matter is pending before the court, since Narasimha Rao has raised the issue about the proceedings of the Supreme Court, I am telling this otherwise.
But
I
you
didn't
have not
want to
answered his
that.
Question, sir. Now, sir, you have not answered his question.
The question is,
Mr. Narayan Swami, why were you not able to convene this house for 6 months?
Let me answer that point. When the matter is pending before the Supreme Court, we filed a petition calling the session of the house. Let me tell you, when the Supreme Court itself, before the Supreme Court itself, the counsel for the governor said that we will not take any precipitate action. And apart from that, the Supreme Court, when they want to give a finding on that, on 14 MLAs, therefore, we said that we decide on the 14 MLAs, then we will convene the session. We wanted to convene the session. When the Supreme Court seized of the matter, we were not able to do it. The permission was not given.
Supreme Court,
I
think.
Just go to
Barkha.
Okay. One minute. GVL Narasimha Rao. GVL Rao, I'm coming to you only. I have one added question. Since the matter was already in the court, why did the cabinet have to move at this point? Why could you not wait for the court to resolve it, GVL Narasimha Rao?
I think, Barkha, they have brought the matter, they have raised the matter before the Honorable Court today. But the reality is the court cannot direct a government to be in the breach of the constitution.
Yes.
The court is there to ensure that the constitution of India is upheld. No court of India will ever want constitution to be breached. And it is the responsibility of the elected government of India to ensure that Indian constitution is upheld. There is no violation of the constitution. And they have been given a chance
but
to put their house.
Could you not have waited for the court to reach his decision?
No.
What was the urgency?
No, certainly no.
Since you had waited all this while, why could you not wait for the court to reach his decision?
No, I think court will take a lot of time. 6 months period has elapsed and Article 174 has been violated. This is actually a 272 moment for Sonia Gandhi. Without having the numbers, what she tried in Parliament more than 15 years ago, she is trying that in Arunachal Pradesh today. They do not have the numbers. They do not have the numbers. They want to bluff. They want to bluff before the country that they have a majority. Let them go and prove it today.
Okay, one at a time. Minarayan Swami, GVL Narasimha Rao says this is a 272. 1 minute, let me ask a question. Narayan Swami says this. Narayan Swami, GVL Narasimha Rao says this is a 272 moment. It is a repeat of Sonia Gandhi claiming that she had the numbers when she famously claimed she had the numbers to form the government at a national level. This is a mini version of that going on in Arunachal Pradesh. You don't have the numbers. That's what the BJP is saying.
It is not like that. I tell you very clearly. Even today, we have the majority. The Congress party has the majority in Arunachal Pradesh. Minus 14 MLAs. 31 MLAs are with us. And we have already told the court that, you know, our numbers are not less than 31. And we will prove it in the floor of the assembly. And we told very clearly. I want to make it very clear. Why the government of India is in a hurry when the constitutional question in the history of India, when the constitutional question relating to the questioning the governor's decision to summon the house is being challenged before the Supreme Court, the Constitution Bench is hearing it in the independent India for the first time. The Narendra Modi government is moving in a hurried manner on a Sunday and calling a cabinet and recommending the president for president rule in Arunachal Pradesh. This itself shows the dubious way in which the government of India is functioning.
GVL Narasimha Rao, did you really want to, let me put it to you differently, did you need to pick this battle right now with an opposition that's already antagonistic to you, whose support you need in the coming session of parliament? You have a budget session coming up, you have legislations waiting. Was it smart politically to move at this moment?
No, this is not political expediency, Barkha. This is a constitutionality that has to be maintained. You cannot perpetrate a constitutional fraud just to appease a recalcitrant opposition. You cannot allow their bluff to prevail. You have to call their bluff. The constitution of India has to be maintained.
Fraud on constitution. We are not doing it.
No. Please go and make your submissions before the Honorable Court. You will be rebuffed.
And trampling all democratic
norms. You have not convened.
Trying to destabilize all opposition rules to governments. North Eastern state and other state.
Hang on. Mr. Narayan Swami, please wait. Let him complete his point. Narayan Swami ji, let GVL Narasimha Rao complete his point. Mr. Rao, make your point. I ask you again. You may make the point that the Congress doesn't have the numbers, but did you need to move at this moment? What explains the timing?
No, I made this very clear. The 6 months time frame, the timeline has already lapsed. I think even the Honorable Supreme Court had asked him to convene the State Assembly on January 20, because on 21, January 21st, the 6 months gap, the timeline was expiring. They did not have the number. They did not want to convene the assembly. You cannot allow this constitutional impropriety to continue. The government was duty bound to do it.
Okay.
The Supreme Court, I'm sure, from the observations of January 16, I can say like very that. Well that we the were, Supreme we Court will uphold.
Okay, let me get Mr. Narayan Swami for a quick last word. Narayan Swami ji, a quick last word.
Yeah.
Narayan Swami ji, you are calculating that you have the numbers, Mr. Narayan Swami. Let me speak, sir. Sir, listen to me. You are calculating that you have the numbers based on your 14 members who have been disqualified. But what if the court does not uphold the disqualification? Then what will you do? Then you do not have the numbers.
No, don't visualize that situation. There are the Congress has got 31 members. Congress has got 31 members also on dead with us. We have got a majority.
272 block.
26 people. Another 5 people are with us. Total 31 people are with the Congress. And we will prove our majority. The governor cannot in a community hall call us, tell them to convene an assembly and prove the majority. It is illegal, unconstitutional, murder of democracy.
Okay.
Then Narendra Modi government
because you have blocked the assembly.
Violating all
you have locked up the assembly. You have adopted violent means. You have adopted unscrupulous means. Not to allow. Not to allow even MLAs inside the state assembly.
Then illegally convene assembly session.
How can you hold up?
Who created the crisis?
How can you hold?
The governor created.
How can you lock up state assembly?
Governor whom you
I think the very behavior of your government against the governor should have been
Mr.
enough
Rao
reason
and Mr.
to actually dismiss this government.
Okay, J.V. Narasimhanswamy, we will leave.
The culprit and you are supporting the culprit. Your governor is the culprit.
No, where are your 31 numbers?
The constitutional crisis in the state.
Don't perpetrate
okay,
a 270.
I can't shout as loud as I can.
What is your number? What is BJP number?
G.V.L. Narasimhanswamy and Meena Narayanaswamy, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Now it's up to the president, it's up to the courts. We leave it there. You can take a deep breath. Mr. Narayanaswamy, Jeevan Narasimha Rao, thank you so much to Mr. Rao and Narayanaswamy for joining us on the Buck Stops here. And as we catch our breath, we're shifting from politics to looking ahead at Republic Day. In an NDTV special, we're bringing you our interview with the Army Chief as well as his interaction with India's future soldiers. These are NCC cadets between the ages of 13 and 21. What are they dreaming of? Does the forge still hold the promise of romance? All that and more coming up in a moment from now.
Good afternoon to all of you.
Thank you, sir.
And wish you all a very happy 2016.
Hello and welcome to this very special program that we're bringing to you from the Army Chief's residence. As you can see, the Chief is busy meeting these young men and women who are all cadets of the NCC. Some of them are going to be part of the Republic Day Parade, but many of them, and they're all between the ages of maybe 13 to 21, want to join the military at some stage. As we leave the Army Day behind and look ahead at the Republic Day, we're also emerging from the shadow of a major terror strike in Pathankot. Many warnings for our soldiers to always be on vigil, as they always are, but also for these young men and women to think about the future and to think about the security situation. Like we said, here we are with the future soldiers, many of them of the country, and the Chief in conversation with them. Let's see if we can get a sense as the Chief is shaking hands with all these cadets here. Sir, good morning. Lovely to see you here. And one doesn't get a chance to talk to you so often, so we thought while you're talking to the cadets, we'd also try and speak to you, sir.
Good afternoon, Prakha.
Sir, you know, I was right here when the Army Day reception happened, and I saw that there was a film, a very wonderful film that you played. And, you know, there you spoke about the need for the soldier to be constantly on vigil. Now, we have, in fact, as you meet these young boys and girls who may, in fact, be the soldiers of the future, we are, in fact, emerging from a major, major terror strike, from the shadows of a major terror strike. Sir, I want to ask you, are you fully satisfied with the way that operation went? Because you've seen the media debate, you've seen many of the experts, in fact, talking about this. So what would you say? Are you satisfied, sir?
Barkha, fully satisfied. Operation was very well coordinated. There was total synergy between all the forces which took part in the operations.
So you have no regrets, and you don't believe any mistakes, as is being suggested in sections of the public commentary.
You see, lessons learned are always there. Even from the successful operations, we have certain lessons to be learned.
Sir, one of the major controversies and talking points has been why the operation took as long as it did. But my sense is that, you know, the military had decided that this was going to be on our terms, that there was going to be no hurry. So do you want to talk a little bit about that? Many questions being asked, why did it take as long as it did to actually declare the base clear of terrorists?
Barkha, I had given three very clear-cut directions to my Army Commander, Western Command.
Yes.
First was safety and security of the Air Force assets, families, and there were also some foreign students. Second was to contain the area of incident.
Yes.
I have a very strong inner and outer cordon, and to make sure that no terrorist can get out. And the third was to avoid casualties and to carry out very deliberate operations. And all three objectives were met. Whatever casualties, fatal casualties were there, they were initially in half an hour, 40, 45 minutes. And after that, there was not a single operational fatal casualty throughout the operations. Hence, it was a very successful operation.
So one of the questions that has been asked is whether there was confusion about the command and control, about who was in authority. In fact, you did say at your Army Day press conference that the Army was in command. But I want you to just clarify this once and for all, because a big criticism has been the impression that the NSG was leading the operations and the Army had to take second place. And there was also confusion about whether the Army was in command, the Air Force was calling the shots, the NSG was calling the shots. So can you clarify this once and for all?
Barkhai clarified during press conference 13th. I again clarify that Army was totally in command of the operations.
So Army was leading the operations?
Definitely. And we
not the NSG?
Not the NSG. It was a coordinated operation, and operation was controlled and coordinated by Army Commander, Western Command. There were 8 columns of the Army which were over there. Then NSG team was there. Garuds were there. Since NSG was there, Garuds were there, Army teams were there. That's why for coordination and operation control, I had put Army Command, Western Command in operation control.
So you just said that there were 8 columns. Initially, it was reported that there were only 2 columns, that the paras were sent, but they were not utilized, that the Army was, you know, just not used to its best ability. You're saying this is not true. And that many more troops were sent than the media reported.
Barkha, I think some sections may not have had the full details of the operations. That's why initially some people reported only 2 columns were there of the Army. Actually, there are 8 columns, and we also had para-SF.
And they were used as they
should have been. All troops which were there were suitably used.
Sir, since one doesn't get a chance to talk to you, and today you were talking to the cadets, so we're just using this opportunity. What would you say about the fact that Punjab has emerged as a kind of new theatre of action? You know, earlier it used to be Jammu and Kashmir, but we're really seeing this is the second strike after Gurdaspur in Punjab. How does the military, how do you as chief read that?
You see, on the line of control, we have got very strong anti-infiltration, counter-infiltration grid.
Yes.
Now they are finding it difficult to cross over from that area. So they are always looking forward to some areas where they can exploit and infiltrate. I think that is the reason now they are extending the arc of infiltration towards Punjab.
So looking for new theatres. Sir, your press conference and even the film you showed at Army Day, it spoke about the challenges of a new kind of terrorism. You know, technology is changing. The internet is a world of faceless enemies. And that was one line that was used in the Army Day film also, I remember seeing here. So talk a little bit about the new terrorism, the new challenge, and therefore the new training that you have to give to your men and women.
You see, basically, the new challenges are in the domain of cyber and asymmetric warfare. And these are the areas we need to now concentrate on.
And that is the biggest challenge.
It is a challenge. It's a major challenge.
So as a woman, I ask you this every year, and I'm seeing so many of these young girls whom I'll be talking to in a while. Nari Shakti was a big part of the Republic Day theme last year. We hope it'll be this year also. You know, the world has moved on. United States has moved for women into combat. And here we are still talking about permanent commission. So at least on permanent commission for women in the Army, will you give us some good news this year?
Definitely, Barkha, we have already taken up case with the ministry, our ministry, to grant permanent commission. Presently only there are 2 areas, Education Corps and JAG branch, where permanent commission for women is there.
Yes.
We are expanding it to other areas, all support, certain support arms and services.
So you would want to open it for more roles?
Yeah, definitely.
When do we think that could happen?
No, we have already taken up the case, and it is with the government. I'm sure it would happen. Only thing is, it has to be with new terms of service.
So you think it could happen very soon?
It should happen. Yes.
Well, one day we hope for an even greater role, sir. But sir, you were here meeting these young men and women. You have been an NCC cadet yourself. So tell us a little bit about that and why you got into it, how you got into it. Aisa kya tha NCC ke baare mein that drew you?
I am from Sainik School, Chittor.
Yes.
NCC was already there.
Yes.
Right from the beginning,
yes,
when the school started. So we were lucky that NCC was part of the curriculum, and it teaches you basically unity and discipline and qualities of leadership. Barkha, about 15,000 plus schools and colleges have this curriculum of NCC, but there are also a large number of schools and colleges.
Who are still on the wait list, I believe.
Yes, they are still on the wait list.
Why is that? Why are there still so many schools waiting to join, and how do you plan to address that? Because on the one hand, we see, you know, I would imagine many of these young men and women could be the future soldiers, you know. So why not use it fully? Why not get more schools and colleges on board?
Yes, we have to. In fact, every school, every college must have NCC.
It's not compulsory right now, so it's optional right now?
No, it's not compulsory in all schools. Yeah. There could be a problem of shortage of staff. Yes. So I feel we'll have to follow the concept of training the trainers.
Okay.
And in that, every school has teachers. Every village has ex-servicemen. They are disciplined soldiers. And we can utilize the teachers and the ex-servicemen. And we need to take this NCC, I think, to the last village.
And using ex-servicemen is a very good idea. So what is your own abiding memory of the NCC that you think really, in a sense, planted the seed for your becoming a soldier?
Barkha, 46 years back, on 26 January 1970, I participated here on Rajpath as part of NCC contingent.
Fantastic. Just imagine. So did you think that day that you could be army chief? I mean, kahan se kahan, sir?
No, I not at all. One has never been thinking on those lines. One is doing its job, yes, and that's it.
So I'm sure these young men and women will be very inspired to hear you, because, I mean, you, as you said, that, you know, there was a day when you were marching in that parade as a cadet. What did you like best about the NCC when you were a cadet?
Discipline. Unity.
Which you still follow. You still run 10 kilometers every day.
Yes. Sometimes when time is not there, maybe less. Not a must. But I try and definitely
do
as much as possible.
You think that discipline began with being a cadet?
There is no doubt about it.
Well, Chief is here. And I want to, with your permission, ask them a question.
Please.
How many of you, and say yes if you agree, want to join the military when you are able to?
I think, as chief, let
you
me
You should ask the question, yes.
Theek
hai, sir.
How many of you want to join? I was, in fact, were you there in the auditorium when I spoke to NCC cadets today?
Yes, sir.
You're there?
Yes, sir.
And how many of you want to join?
Sir!
That's all hands up.
I want, if say yes, and if I want both hands up, in case you are really motivated. Yeah, that's it. Excellent. In fact, in the auditorium also, everyone raised the hands. And I'm glad that you are on right lines. As I told you, one thing which is common to NCC and to the Army is unity and discipline. And we are the best examples of unity in diversity,
yes,
isn't it?
Yes, sir.
All the best. Thank God bless you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Barkha.
Pleasure to have this chance to talk to you.
Thank you, Barkha.
Thank you. And I'm looking forward to talking to all of them. So please come on. Why don't you take a seat? And I'm going to have really looking forward to hearing your stories. So come on, bed jaiye. Let me start by just asking all of you to tell me a little bit about yourself. So I have your Deeksha. Deeksha, aap kahan se hai?
I'm Cadet Deeksha from Haryana.
I believe you're a boxer.
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about how you got into boxing.
Yeah, I was inspired by my big brother. He got the medal in the Commonwealth Games. His name is Neeraj Goyat.
Okay. So tell me something. Do you feel that there was some resistance because you're a woman? And, you know, sometimes young girls have to go through different kinds of pressure. Unpe alag alag tarah ka hi dabav aata hai. Did people say, come on, you're a woman, you shouldn't be boxing, you shouldn't be a cadet? Did you have to go through that?
Yeah, it was there. But when we really want to do something, so some things are there that that will definitely come in our way. But
what kind of pressure did you have to face?
Especially my mother, she was not at all ready.
Kya boli wo?
Yeah, she said that as you are a woman, so this is not your profession and this is ye aapke liye nahi bana hai.
So aapne kya bola unko?
So I said that I will made it. If it is not made for me, so I will made it for me.
If it's not for me, I'll make it for
you. Yeah, I'll make
fantastic.
It for me.
Fantastic. Okay, so and what's your name? Khushi. Khushi, apne baare mein bataiye.
My name is Khushi Gupta.
Yes.
I am 13 years old.
13? Are you the baby of the group?
Yes, I am.
Are you the youngest? Are you the youngest? Is anyone younger than Khushi here? Anyone younger? Oh my God. Come on. There's somebody. I'm coming back to you. Are you younger than Khushi? You mean you're younger than 13?
Yes, ma'am.
How old are you?
12 and a half.
12 and a half. Okay. So we'll what's your name?
My name is Hidhanshu Slatia.
Okay. So I'm going to come back and talk to you and I'm going to go back to Khushi. So Khushi, there's somebody who's 6 months younger than you, but that's okay. So tell me about yourself. Where are you from?
I'm from Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh Directorate.
Okay.
And I'm a professional theatre artist. And I'm
Wow, at the age of 13, you're a professional theatre artist.
I'm performing theatre since last 9 years.
Okay.
And perform more than 100 to 500 shows in theatre and ballet both. And I'm getting a CCRT scholarship from Ministry of Culture in theatre and ballet under my guru Vishali Gupta ma'am.
Okay, so now since theatre seems to be your first love, how come you became an NCC cadet?
I became an NCC cadet because both of them resembles. George Bernard Shaw have said that theatre would be a last family. But when I came in NCC, I saw that NCC too is there for unity in diversity.
Okay.
So both resembles a lot, and that is why I'm here in NCC too to give my human resource here too. And
you're also the Guinness Book of World Records, right?
Yes.
So now I want to ask you, since all of you, when the chief was here, you all said that you know you want to be part of the military, right? So what do you want to do when you're older? You really want to be part of the force?
Yeah, I want to be there in the Indian Army.
Yeah.
Yes.
And you think women should be allowed into combat also?
Yeah, definitely.
I think so. I always tell, I say this to the chief every year.
Definitely, it should be there.
Yeah.
And really, I want to be there in the fighting arms.
Yeah.
Right now, it is not there, but I hope that it will be there.
So all those here who think that it's time now, I hope the men will also agree, for women to be allowed into more active combat roles, raise your hand. Come on, raise your hand. Raise your hand and keep it there. And so we hope that everybody is listening to this, because look at these vibrant young women and they really have to be led into bigger roles. So you're Swati. So I believe you're the daughter of a paratrooper.
Yes, ma'am.
Tell us a little bit about your dad and what he does.
Ma'am, he's from 17 Parafield.
Yeah.
And all my life I've seen him, seen his maroon cap. And I always aspired to be a paratrooper. But later I came to know that when I grew up, I came to know that that's not allowed for women. But being a part of the NCC, I came to know that in the month of August, there's a camp in Agra where you get opportunity to take 3 jumps.
Okay.
So I want to do that. So I want to be like him. I aspire to be in the Indian Army like him.
And how is he responding to your wanting to do these 3 jumps?
He's very supportive. He's like, go for it.
Fantastic. I really love meeting dynamic young women who dream big. Now, let me come back here to the baby of the group, right? Now, where are you from?
I'm from J&K Directorate.
J&K? Kahan se?
I'm Samba.
Samba? So aap to border ke paas rehte hain phir?
Yes, ma'am.
So aap to dekhte honge wahan to kafi kuch terrorist activity, infiltration chalta rehta hai.
Yes, ma'am.
Although bachcho ko is umar pe ye sab janna bhi nahi chahiye, lekin Samba mein rehte hain to...
It's a border sector.
Border sector.
Yes, ma'am.
Achha, I believe that you've also acted in a movie.
Yes, ma'am.
So tell me about that movie.
It is about migration in Kashmir.
About the Kashmiri Pandits?
Yes, ma'am. When 19 January 1990, when migration is going on in the Kashmir,
okay.
It's about that ek family pe ek bachche pe kya biti ki jab wo migration wahan pe chal rahi thi.
Aur aapki family ne ye khud experience kiya hai migration ki wo hamesha se hi Samba mein rehte the?
Nahin, ma'am. We are from Samba.
You're from Samba only. So, yahan pe hamare paas Samba Jammu sector se hain. Aur aap Sopor se hain?
Yes, ma'am.
Tell me your name.
Arslan.
So now Sopor is considered a, you know, or in when things were bad, it was considered a militant hotbed. Separatist sentiment bhi kafi wahan pe high hai. So how did you get attracted to the NCC and maybe in the future the military?
Basically, I was not attracted to NCC.
Hmm.
I was knowing nothing about NCC.
Hmm.
The thing I knew was about army. And what inspired me about the army is a little bit strange. When I was a child and... army person used to walk through the Sopor because, as you said, it's a disturbed area.
Yeah.
So when the army person used to walk and for patrolling and the army trucks used to move, I saw many little children waving their hands to the army trucks and to the army person. And this thing, I was thinking about it. Why are they doing this thing only to the army men? There are rest of the people walking. Why is only army men getting such a respect? What's there in the army? why are they doing it?
So you got curious about
it? I was thinking about it. I was very curious to know, yes, why is this happening to army? Yes. Then I came to know it's not the person who is being respected. It's the uniform. It's the dress up that's being respected. And I want to wear the dress. For this, I struggled. Like in my family, no one was there to support me to join the army.
And were they opposed to it? No. Kya bole wo?
They were supporting, but I could not get the right guidance.
Okay. But how did your friends and Sopor react? You know, it is an area where many people may have said, "Kyun kar rahe ho ye?"
Yeah, my friends. I often have a tiff over this thing with my friends. This
jhagda hota hai?
Yeah, not that kind of jhagda, but
arguments
are there. Every time there are arguments in my tuitions when I studied, there were arguments all the time. They used to tell me, "Why are you going to join the army?" And they used to say, "Me, we'll do this to you, we'll do that to you when you'll come back after joining the army." I said, "Okay, fine, do whatever you want. I have to join the army. I'm not scared about all these things."
But it was your own decision.
It's my own decision to join the army, and my family is also supporting me. They are supporting me to join the army.
Are you the only young person from all of Sopor to become a cadet and dream of joining the military?
No, there are many cadets from Sopor, but I think I'm dreaming for cracking the NDA. For this thing, I got a lot of support from army men also, because I visited many.
And parents are supporting? Or are they a bit worried?
They are a little bit worried in the hearts of heart, but they are supporting. Okay, you can go. It's your dream. Settle.
And you've come all the way from Kargil, right, Nawaz?
Yes, ma'am.
What's your dream?
My dream is army, join army officer.
Aap kahan rehte hain Kargil ke area mein?
Kargil Apati.
और आपने जब वॉर हुई थी 99 में आपने सुना होगा उसके बारे में?
जब वॉर हुई थी तब मेरा उम्र 2-3 साल था।
Alright, let's talk to some other people and tell us a little bit about yourself, Praveen. Yes, so where are you from, Praveen?
Ma'am, I'm from Rajasthan Directorate.
Okay, and how did you come into the NCC? How old are you?
Ma'am, basically my father was in army.
Okay.
He served army more than 24 years.
Okay.
So basically, I want to follow the path of my father.
Okay, so now I want to ask you all something. You know, all of you are talking about joining the military, but actually a lot of young people today want to do other things. You know, unko lagta hai ki koi kuch aur karke paisa zyada banega or it'll be a more easy life. Like, so do you all discuss this amongst yourselves that it'll be a tough life? Let's get somebody who wants to talk about it.
Ma'am, this is Cadet Shailendra Dev from Delhi Directorate. And yes, of course, ma'am, because private sector is providing a lot of incentives and a lot of good life, great life. And of course, we can make a lot of money from private sectors. But army is the place which gives ocean of opportunities and number of opportunities. If we want to participate in the sports, it gives opportunity to participate in the sports. If we want to have a challenging life, highly challenging life is assured in army. So that is the main thing which the young cadets, as young cadets, we want.
So do you still feel there's a romance and an adventure to the military? Because a lot of people say that wo jo josh tha aajkal ke bachchon mein nahi hai.
No, ma'am, not true.
Not true?
Not true.
Come, why don't you stand and tell us about yourself?
Myself, Pallavi Bijaj. I'm from West Bengal and Sikkim Directorate. I'm presently doing my BCom honours in St. Xavier's College, second year.
So you're doing BCom. Yeah. So you could go into any stream you want to.
That's
right?
What I'm saying. I wanted to join the corporate world. I wanted to become a finance manager. But then after joining NCC, I got motivated after seeing the officers over here that they work so hard for our country. So why not go something related to armed forces? Why not join defense forces? So now my motive is changing and I want to join the armed forces.
What changed your mind? Like what is the one thing you just love that you've learned in the
uniform, NCC? The uniform that they wear. It actually makes us feel proud. The uniform that they wear, people actually go and salute everybody out there. So I want that salute from people, from other cadets passing by. So that has motivated me a lot. Also the unity and discipline that we see.
A lot of you are essentially children. Okay, like if you're looking at it from my point of view, my age, for me, you're bachchas. Now, all of you are saying discipline. Now, when I was your age, I was very indisciplined. Now, I'm sure you all are indisciplined also sometimes. Come on, be honest. Come on. I want to hear about the stories of indiscipline. And your teachers and trainers have to promise to not scold you for what you're going to tell us. So tell us, is this your age to be so disciplined?
Yes, ma'am, definitely.
पर कभी कभी indiscipline भी तो होता होगा
मैम. थोड़ा बहुत indiscipline के बारे में अगर हम कहें तो हम लोग indiscipline दिखाते हैं थोड़ा सा, 5 मिनट लेट होकर टाइम पे आना. हम लोगों को यहाँ पे पंचुअलिटी डिसिप्लिन सिखाया जाता है. टाइम से 5 मिनट लेट हो गए तो वो हमारे लिए indiscipline होता है.
बहुत इंडियन स्टैंडर्ड टाइम.
राइट मैम.
सभी 5 मिनट लेट मिनिमम होता है
मैम. यहाँ पे सभी एग्री.
अच्छा बताइए, जब लेट होते हैं तो बहुत डांट पड़ती है?
Yes, ma'am. -2. Ma'am, -2.
What happens?
-2.
You get minus mark for the directory.
Okay, one minute. Once again, you get -2.
We get a -2 points to each directory who comes late.
You get -2 for being 5 minutes late.
Yes.
Oh God. Okay, wait. You tell me. You tell me. One minute.
Ma'am, we have a competition going on between 17 directorates. Yeah. So once if any directorate cadet is late, -2 for the cadet and the directorate.
And so that is what motivates you all to be on time.
Yes, ma'am, definitely.
But you all, she said, thoda indiscipline to hota hai. So one example that's been given to me is 5 minutes late. What are the other kinds of things that?
Shouting. Yes, ma'am. When they ask us to keep quiet, we keep talking, coughing, wantedly, deliberately they do that. So that is one big indiscipline which we see there.
But don't you sometimes feel that this is not my age to be so? How old are you?
I'm 20 years old.
So don't you think that sometimes, oh, this is my age to be free? I don't really want to be disciplined.
Ma'am, we should be disciplined in our life. Discipline is one essence of life which we should all follow. And here is the NCC gives us an exposure to be disciplined apart from a civilian life in which we can carry out in what form we want.
So do you find that people your age are still willing to go through that discipline, or are some people very scared of it? Ye bhi hota hoga na? Huh? Wait. Come here. Tell me about yourself. What's your name? Rachit.
Where are you from? Ma'am, I am from Uttar Pradesh Directorate. Huh. Ma'am, it is told to us that discipline is the bedrock of the success. Hmm. And NCC provides us an opportunity, not only in our cadet life, but in all walks of life, in all spheres. Hmm. It provides an opportunity to have leadership qualities.
But are none of you ever naughty?
No, ma'am. Being a cadet...
You are. Okay, raise your hand. Who's... Okay, Vatsya, you know what's really nice is to see all the girls saying that we are very naughty and all the boys pretending to be very well behaved. So, Khushi, how are you naughty?
Ma'am, when in the roll call, they say Savdhan, and whenever he says Savdhan, everybody start coughing, and whenever say don't cough, so everybody start coughing more louder.
Okay, now tell me here, somebody who's in the NCC but wants to do something else. Do any of you think of doing something else? Come forward.
Ma'am, I want to be an IPS officer because my inspiration is Kiran Bedi and I inspire from her.
Okay, Kiran Bedi, of course, was an NCC cadet herself. So that's of course, interesting. So let's hear from some more voices here. You're Monica and you're Sapna. Come on, give me space. So where are you from?
From Punjab Directorate.
Punjab se ho?
Yes, ma'am.
Kahan se?
Ma'am, local Punjab. Ma'am, Hisar, Haryana.
Acha, to kaise aaye aap isme?
Ma'am,
अच्छा हरियाणा एक ऐसा प्रदेश है जहाँ पे सेक्स रेशियो के फिगर्स भी बहुत डिस्टर्बिंग रहे हैं. राइट, यू ऑल नो दिस. राइट, बच्चियों को पैदाइश से पहले ही मार दिया जाता है. फीमेल फीटिसाइड इज सच अ सीरियस थिंग. सो इट्स वेरी नाइस टू सी समबडी लाइक यू. तो परिवार ने कैसा रिस्पॉन्ड किया जब आपने कहा मैं कैडेट बनना चाहती हूँ?
मैम, जब मैंने कहा कि मैं RDC के लिए जा रही हूँ तो मेरे पापा ने कहा कि हाँ आप जाइए, और मम्मी ने भी साथ दिया, सबने परिवार ने साथ दिया, और फोन भी आते हैं कि हाँ बेटा कैसे चल रहा है ये सब. और
तो बर्ताव क्या बदल गया है?
नो मैम, सेम ही है.
नहीं, जैसे लोग पहले दबाव डालते थे लड़कियों पे,
वो बदल गया है.
बदल गया है. ओके
मैम, मेरे पेरेंट्स इस चीज़ के लिए हमेशा से सपोर्टिव रहे हैं. मेरे मॉम एंड डैड बहुत ज़्यादा सपोर्ट करते हैं. मेरी हम 3 सिस्टर्स एक ब्रदर है. सभी को सब चीज़ों के लिए सपोर्ट किया जाता है. बट हमारे आसपास में गांव इलाके जो भी है वहाँ के लोगों का कहना कुछ और ही है. वो डायरेक्टली बोल देते हैं कहाँ भेज रहे हो, क्या कर रहे हो, लड़की को इतनी दूर भेजना सही नहीं है. मैम, वो चीज़ें अभी शायद चेंज हो जाएंगी.
कहाँ है आपका गाँव?
मैम, मैं बेसिकली हिमाचल प्रदेश से हूँ. हाँ. शिमला से हूँ. हाँ. और शिमला मैम विलेज से बिलोंग करती हूँ. तो मैम वहाँ के लोगों का कहना है कि कहाँ भेज रहे हो, बट पेरेंट्स बहुत सपोर्टिव है, फैमिली बहुत ज़्यादा सपोर्टिव है. अब मैं वापस जाके देखना चाहूँगी लोगों का रिएक्शन, बिकॉज मुझे लगता है मैंने कुछ लाइफ में अचीव किया है यहाँ आके.
Hello ma'am, I'm Cadet Shivali Ghelot from UP Directorate. I just want to tell you that my parents are very supportive. They are always there with me. My father especially, and he encourages me. He is my the only inspiration. He wanted to me in the armed forces, and he only get me admitted in the NCC. And my family, my friends, they all are very supported.
And your grandparents were both in the army? Both yes, grandfathers?
Yes, ma'am.
And you've got a best NCC cadet prize?
Yes, ma'am. Okay. At this state
good
level.
For you. All right, let's take some last comments. Where's Dhwani? Where's Dhwani? Yeah. Dhwani, tell me about yourself.
Ma'am, my name is Dhwani. I'm from Delhi Directorate. And I'm a professional Bharatanatyam dancer. I've attended many spikmikes. I've been also a bronze medalist of International Award for Young People. And I love dancing. And that's
and
it.
You play football, right?
Yes, ma'am.
So how did the boys react when you started playing football? Do they sort of say, oh, girls can't really play?
Ma'am, I was from a girls' school.
Okay, so you didn't have to deal with that?
Yeah, I didn't have to.
Okay. What's the one thing you've learned that you really think will prepare you for anything? Anything. Come to the front.
Ma'am, what we have learned is how to handle pressure and time management. That's must. It's an honor walking on Rajpath. You're representing the youth power of your country, not only to the people of your country, but to the whole world. And that gives you a pride, feeling of pride.
I'm sure. I think that's so well said. Where are you from?
Ma'am, I'm Cadet to Jaswi Sharma from Punjab Directorate. I'm from Shimla, Himachal Pradesh.
Well, I think that's very well said, that it helps us deal with pressure. It gives us a sense of pride. It gives you a sense of purpose. And it gives you a sense of discipline, even though there's some little indiscipline sometimes. I think that's allowed. So let's have a big round of applause for not just all of you and your dreams, but for your fellow cadets and for all the entire military community. Let's have a big round of applause.